I am unashamed. What about you?
Yeah, so I'll just lead that
well,
into that.
Well, Phil was going to talk about the coffee or something.
I know, I'm going to ask him about it. So we got some good coffee here to get us going. We're still in our makeshift. This is our last couple of podcasts. Hopefully, Lord willing, if another hurricane doesn't show up. This is our last makeshift WFR.
And you think about it, we had my electricity had never gone off for more than an hour in 13 years living up here in town.
Right.
And then it goes off for 5 days. So everybody's like, why don't you have a generator? I was like, well, for 13 years, I didn't need one.
Right.
And I'm not sure they'd hold up that much. Well, then Missy said, let's go buy a generator. Of course, couldn't find one at that point because everybody just bought one. And I was like, what are the odds that this is going to happen again? And then what was it, a month later?
Yeah, does again.
Down for 3 days. So then I called the energy company because I was like, because right across the street, they got power. I said, what's it cost to get hooked up on that line? You know what he said? You need to go buy a generator.
He said what Dad said.
I said, well, just give me the number and let me deal with it. He said, I'd go buy a generator. I was like, yeah, but just...
just for funsies.
Just... So I called Missy and told her that, and she's like, I want that number. I was like, babe, what do you want me to do?
It's a big one, I'm sure. So that was interesting. I told y'all, we talked about on previous podcasts that we bought two generators. I mean, we were waiting for them to come off the truck.
That didn't make me feel very good.
And then neither one of them lasted a day. So I load them back up on the truck. Lisa goes out there. Because I told you she was going to get the money back. And I was wrong. She didn't get the money back. She comes back with two more brand new generators.
But look, let me tell you this. I told Missy.
Are the same model?
Same model, same one. Now, the boxes aren't tore up on this, so I don't know.
Well, Missy picked one out and said, what about this one? I said, nope, don't want that. I said, that's too cheap. She's like, well, why would they be offering it? I said, that's for people who are trying to save some money and buy a generator. Well, after that story happened, she's like, I guess Al and Lisa were the ones you're talking about. I was like, well, can't buy a cheap generator.
Our problem was it was the only ones in town, cheap or not. But look, they cost $1,000 a piece. Is that cheap on the generator
That's
scale?
Cheap. That's
is
cheap.
It? Oh, was that it? No. But now I am getting the big boy at the house. I mean, I'm convinced of that. It may not happen for another 7 years. It's been about 6 years for me.
Just watched one thing. Unlike every 13 years, when you get dependent on somebody, the Apostle Paul had it right, you know, live a quiet life, mind your own business, and work hard so your daily life will win the respect of others so that you won't have to be dependent on anybody. So you've got that as an admonition. So you say, well, how often did you find yourself in a situation where you would lose power, complete power, gone, and you had to drag up some. I had like a welding machine. I kept the electricity.
However, though,
I had the welding machine. I'd already purchased it. I knew I had that in case the power went out.
Right.
So I pulled the welder up there, gasoline job every 4 or 5 hours, fill it up again. But we had electricity and first one thing another. So we did pretty well. But from that, I thought, well, for coming to pretty big bucks, I'll just go top of the line. All, you know, where if my power leaves, a 10-second delay, you don't have power, and then boom, it automatically comes on, and it'll run for a month. It's got enough fuel for a month. So I decided when I'm getting in the generator business, I've noticed, I said, about a couple of times a year, we lose our electricity.
Yeah.
But I live way out of a subdivision. I'm down there at the end of the road in the woods. So the bottom line is when you have to cut your way out for a mile with chainsaws and heavy equipment just to get up the road, it happened to us twice this month, but I already had the generator there prepared for such an event as that, and it might have come along 30 years later, but at least I'd have been sitting there saying, I'm ready,
but
whatever
see,
happens.
What my theory is, the reason – you're not dependent on anybody is because the people that are around you are not dependable. Now, it's like your coffee.
Well,
you told me about this coffee. I'm like, how could a man drink 3-year-old coffee? Well, you can tell the story, but you were dependent on someone.
A connoisseur of fine coffee, they never relegate the particular skill set it takes to get a good cup of coffee. It's difficult. Most people, well, what do you do? How many grounds? Well, how many grounds? How much water? They don't understand. But this morning I was in a bind because the beavers bored tunnels underneath my levee. The 6-inch rain come along. They did it when the water was low on the side that we duck hunt. Water was down. So they bored holes, tunnels, all the way through the thing, about 3 of them, unbeknown to me. I didn't know they had done that. Well,
you didn't get an email about
a 6-inch rain hits and the water goes to the top of that levee overnight. What would have taken me a month to pump it in there? The Almighty did it in one night. So I went down there and I noticed that, of course, I opened it wide open and just let it blow out. But I looked on the left-hand side of that pipe and I saw a big ball there. I thought, So I said, I said, that looks like that's not going through the pipe. I wonder how it's getting there. Well, as it started draining down, we noticed that when we shut the pipe back down, now we got full stop. Water was still coming out of that ball. And I said, there is a hole through this levee somewhere. Well, I couldn't see it on. I looked all around, and finally, I walked up about 20 yards from where the water was boiling beside the pipe I had just closed. I walked up about, and I was looking out there at that water. I was looking for any kind of swirl or like a little slow commode flush circle. I was looking for a circle of water somewhere, I said, because that much water would create.
Yeah,
its source would tell me. Well, I walked up about 20 yards, and I looked out there, and I saw it was about this big around. It was doing like this, just sitting there. Of course, there's about 6 feet of water on it, so it was just making a little deal like this. I got red. I called him up, said, get down there with that track hoe. I came down and I walked up. I said, see that little commode flush there? See that little circle? He said, that's where that water 20 yards away. That's where that water's going. I said, it's going through this side right there. I said, you got to
plug that.
And look, it was at an angle, so it was like 20 yards of levee.
Right, what are we using here?
Right down the middle of the levee.
Concrete, dirt?
Concrete, dirt, and all. So I got him out there, and I mean, In 30 minutes, he had a trench cut, 8 foot deep. I mean, piling on both sides. He was just trying to, from the spot that was twirling, he had to dig the whole tunnel up, cave it all back in, pack it down. So that's what I was doing. Y'all called and said, come up here to this.
Well, how was the coffee? Mud. When did the coffee?
Yeah, you said you were in a bind.
While I was waiting on Red to finish the job so I could come up here to do the podcast, I said, what time you got? He said, it's 10:30. I said, tell you what you do. Run back up at the house, get me a thermos full of coffee, and bring it down here, and I'll have a little coffee here waiting on Red to finish the job. I said, then I'll take off to the podcast. So I send a eunuch up to put the coffee bottle.
And undependent.
Well, he comes back and hands me the coffee bottle. I looked at it. I said, that's not the one I've been using, but I said, I guess it's all right. What he didn't realize is the stale coffee had been in this thing for a couple of years. You would have thought, I said, fill the coffee bottle up, with coffee. I meant first pour out the old coffee.
You would think anybody would know how to do
it. Flush it out, put some hot water in the bottle where to heat it up, where your coffee will stay hot.
Yeah.
He didn't either. He got an old coffee bottle. I've been out there on the porch for about, a couple of years. And of course, you say, well, how did you find that out? The first little sip, I said, whoa. Because if you look down in a coffee bottle that you don't use for 2 years with a flashlight, what you'll see is mold at the bottom about this tall, a green mold.
And you drank it.
I drank one sip of it. I grinned and I said, that boy. I said, these millennials, I said, I tell you.
And then you thought of that verse, as far as it depends on you. Do not be dependent on anybody.
There you go.
Because see, you say, well, how did I know that? Because Jay heard about it and called me and said, Phil drank some coffee that had been in a bottle a couple of years. Ha, ha, ha.
But you forgot, if it's possible, try to live at peace with all men. So you said, what did you say that when you saw that? I just thought, he's younger, he's a millennial. He just hasn't done that. He hasn't made coffee and put it in a coffee. He never had done that.
Yeah, well, Dan's got a bigger disconnect. It's not just he's a millennial. Dan, the way he thinks, he can't. I've never seen anybody in my life, and he's great at what he does for us. But he doesn't have any common sense.
He is in my line of work, what I do, down in the woods this morning, come up here, podcast yesterday, interviews, talking to people from all over the United States.
He's the number one man for me.
He is indispensable.
Oh, exactly.
But Phil, let me give you a tip.
Him, but we've got to have a coffee tutorial.
Can you imagine somebody like that working in a restaurant? No.
Right.
You see, I mean, because you don't, most people, if they found a coffee bottle, I don't care if they drank coffee or not, they would open it and dump it out, or you know,
or at least
and look at you. Wouldn't
he never had done that before? But
there's common sense.
Dan's not like that. Dan's a linear thinker. He's a linear. He doesn't.
It was not a game changer.
And what's wrong with his smelling capability? Because I'm sure when he pops that top.
If it's possible, as far as it depends on you, try to live at peace with all men. So I took that. I applied that thing. I just set the coffee bottle in the back. I said, well, I'll give them a little update on how you get the
fresh
coffee.
I agree. But like when you take milk, what's the first thing you do?
Smell it.
You smell it.
I mean, that's milk 101. I would never drink milk that I didn't smell first.
You know, Missy, she said, what are you doing? I just bought that milk. I said, I'm smelling it. It doesn't matter that you just bought it.
And
then they'll say, but the date on that, I said, it doesn't matter what the date is.
I don't go by the date. I go by the smell.
All the old women, they put the smell test, everything like that.
And you taught us to do it. I always saw you put the smell test to everything. And I do the same thing.
I smell every chicken that we eat. I open that package up, put the smell test.
Mm-hmm. Me too.
Amazingly, I would say maybe in 50 years, half a dozen. You smell?
It's not many.
Whoa. Wrong.
Yeah.
Out it goes. But if I'd have got it all cut up and cooked without doing that, the smell test is something that needs to be done on a lot of different kinds of
foods. But you know what? I just thought about it. It may be hereditary for Dan, because you remember that story that time when Gary and Pam lived here, which Dan would have been a boy. They bought a chicken, one of these cooked chickens, like from the grocery store, and the thing had maggots.
I remember
in it, and they ate it until they got down.
Because they're not a redneck. I mean, it's like when you think about.
I mean, literally, it was a ruined chicken, and they ate it and got sick
with maggots crawling out of it.
What we are labeled affectionately as redneck culture, it's people who live off the land. We realize we go hunt animals and we process it.
And you realize how quickly things spoil.
I mean, you think about, I heard a guy one time, I think he was joking, but he was like, I mean, who do you think invented milk for human consumption? He's like, that's two rednecks in a barn playing truth or dare.
I mean, let's take a break on that one.
So one of the things that is surprising, not really to us because we talk about it quite a bit, is that as something gets more popular and more people do it, it attracts more thieves and people willing to steal. I mean, would you say that's a common truth, Dad?
It's an age-old truth.
Well, now that so many people are on the computer, we've got cybercrime up, like 75%, the FBI says. And one of the things that they're doing is they're finding people's titles to their home online, and they're hacking into some bank or some mortgage company, and basically they take your home title and make it theirs. They borrow a bunch of money on it. You foreclose. You never even knew you didn't have your house. I mean, it's a scary thing when you really think about it. And so we have a company, Home Title Lock, that has a way to protect your home title. So it's HomeTitleLock.com. You register your address. Make sure you're not already a victim. Then use the code radio and you get 30 free days of protection just for trying these guys out. So that's HometitleLock.com with the code radio.
Or that thought the same thing for who's the first guy that tried the egg. You know, chicken comes by and it comes out of the chicken's butt. And they're like, that thing may be good to eat. I mean, the first
that's
guy.
That's what I'm saying.
The first guy that tried that, my hat's off to him.
I'll tell you this. It came from people who live like we do.
That's right.
Who are around animals. And
there is an old saying in the redneck world, anything that you don't know what it is, but it's, for whatever reason, has died. Sometimes you shoot it and it dies. You walk up there and you look at it, and if you don't know what it is, you say, I wonder what that is. The next question is always there. I wonder if you can eat that.
That's how all things that we eat.
If you look at one, if you look at a crawfish crawl by, most people would say, no. I don't think so.
Most people still do. You know, that aren't from around here.
Well, my Nicaraguan daughter.
A frog. You look at a frog, you're like, you're going to eat that?
Well, when my Nicaraguan daughter saw those crawfish, because we boiled crawfish, I said, boy, you're in, Karina, you're in for a treat. But she's like, well, they're not ready. I said, no, they're ready. You participate in the process. You pick, so I showed her how to do it, but she was scared to touch it. I was like, they're dead. No good.
It's like, what? Like, when I'm raising a leg or something,
I'm not eating that. Well, you talk about frogs, they actually
move around in the pan.
Yeah, that's where they got that from. The way their body is constructed.
Yeah, they're
even once you clean them, they're still an occasional
jerky.
Which is kind of freaky because, I mean, if you're like, remember you used to work for that hospital and you said every once in a while, because you transport the dead bodies, every once in a while they start moving or passing gas or whatever.
Yeah, because your body is still is shutting down. It's you're gone, but things can still happen. And, man, I had this guy, Emilio was his name. And, I mean, we were in that elevator and all of a sudden it was just a big gas and then poop from this dead body. And when that elevator opened, he hit the door wide open and he never came back. He was out after that. So he lived in my neighborhood and I said, what happened to you last night? We worked at night. And I said, what happened to you last night? He said, oh, bro, he had a thick his back. I said, oh, anybody that could poop like, he didn't say poop, but anybody that could poop like that ain't dead enough for me. Yeah, I ain't going back.
Yeah,
and he never
would,
did.
That would be weird.
Yeah. And they would twitch and stuff like that. Yeah. So I guess you're right. It's the same thing.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know. Dad's the only person in the world that would find a verse that says, this is why you need to buy a generator. I thought that was pretty good. Only Dad could find the scriptural background for that statement. That's pretty good. So, Jase, Sunday, I preached on John 13. We had technical difficulties, so you didn't get to watch it.
But I was watching until but we had just had a hurricane.
We've had two hurricanes, and somehow we think that's impact for those of you that have been trying to watch. We apologize.
Exact same path.
Right.
12
miles apart. I mean, what are the odds? 12 minutes. But of course, then they showed one from like a few years ago. I don't remember it. It wasn't that long ago.
It's happened before.
Yeah, it was in Florida. And literally on that one, I mean, it almost hit exact like an X. Like one came from this way and one came from this way.
I thought maybe it does something to the atmosphere and maybe it just finds like a trough. You know,
it could be.
Whatever. I mean, I don't know. It just seems weird.
What was interesting about these two is that when they came at the same spot. But that first one, because of atmospheric stuff going on differently, went straight up through Shreveport and then went across in Arkansas. Mm. Of course, we got the worst damage from that one, but because it was a more fierce storm. But then that second one, it peeled off and came right across here. I mean, actually right across you.
Right
across. Came across south of us down there. Really interesting. But anyway, so we did this. I did the title of my sermon was The God of the Towel. And so for those of you watching, I have a copy of the book. Yeah. And it's by a guy that Jase talks about a lot on the podcast, Jim McGuigan. So I thought about the title because I was doing John 13 from him. And this is a great book on God himself. But then he has one chapter in there that I loved getting to read again about.
Haven't read it in so long. I can't remember it. Did he make the point? You know, when we went through John 13, I made the point that I think when Jesus stressed that he would wrapped the towel around him. He got the water. He, you know, I made a point where, I mean, I think it was John's point that the way he fired back at Peter, because he said, unless I cleanse you, you can have no part of me.
Right.
And I made a point that that's the way we're cleansed. There's nothing we can do. And I think he was setting that precedent as a precursor to the cross. Did he make that point?
He did. Yeah. And a couple of things that I was going to just, I thought I'd just tell y'all some of what I talked about.
Well,
and
maybe that's where I got the point.
Before you do that, I just want to interject here. This whole thing about fruit bearing, I'll just give you from Matthew. Matthew 3, I mentioned this the other day, but this is a little more fuel to it. Here comes John the Baptist, and he looks up and he sees Pharisees and Sadducees coming to where he was baptizing. He said, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee the coming wrath?" Now, he goes right directly to this point. Produce fruit in keeping with repentance. So the understory of fruit-bearing human beings, it comes from a change of heart in keeping with repentance. So when you say, why is it so necessary? Well, that's Matthew 3. Matthew 7, Jesus said, "Watch out for false prophets. They come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ferocious wolves." And he makes an incredible statement. But you think about it logically, you say, you know, he's onto something there. On how you can tell who the false prophets are and who the godly are. How do you tell? He said, "By their fruit, you will recognize them." And he says, "Do people pick grapes from thorn bushes or figs from thistles?" He said, "No." Likewise, every good tree bears good fruit. If you recognize a human being and what they're made of and who they are, you say, just watch what they are doing from day to day to day to day. Every good tree bears good fruit, but a bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot bear bad fruit, and a bad tree cannot bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. It is critical. When you read all these texts, by their fruit, you will recognize them. Now, that's twice he said, you will know an individual by the fruit he bears. For example, if filth is coming out of a man's mouth and he's claiming, it's just filth out of his mouth, but if he claims to be a follower of Jesus Christ, you're like, no, nope. If that's the way you recognize someone, what fruit they're bearing, if they're up to no good, it comes forth. If they're given to lying, rioting, looting, shooting, just pick the one you want. You're like,
but it's not just negative. It's like, what, to go to Al's point, you don't see these people carrying around a towel washing people's feet. Just the opposite. Even in the religious world, it's more of, you know, I'm using it as an illustration, but it's like they like their feet being washed.
Because think about it. If you see somebody and then you meet somebody and then you're with somebody over a period of time, whoever she is and whoever he is, oh, it's going to come forth.
Usually in about 5 minutes.
It may take a little time. You say, but the fruit they bear, Al, no matter what happens, that's how you're going to recognize them.
Exactly.
They either have it or they don't. You look at a text that says, but the fruit of the Spirit, after he gave the acts of the sinful nature are obvious, and he goes through the list. All this divisions, dissensions, factions, envy, orgies, goes through the whole list. Then he says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love. You say, good fruit. Joy, good fruit. That's why when you see angry people and you wonder why, that's the fruit they're bearing. They're angry, and you say they have fruit. The fruit of anger is coming out of them. Instead of peace, you see there's always this friction with them, with each other, with other people. You're like, well, you just add them all up, love, joy, peace, patience, people to, you know, throw it, flipping to the bone, going down the road, And you say, what in the world? Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness. So now they even to the point in America where women are offended if you open the door or if you say something like, yes, ma'am, no, ma'am. They're like, hey, don't be telling, don't talk to me like that. Don't call me ma'am. So they're taking away little acts of kindness. We're from the South. When I'm talking to older woman or whatever, I'm like, yes, ma'am. How's it doing? Thank you, ma'am. I'm doing it as a term of endearment. And they're
and
saying,
respect.
Hey.
And respect.
And respect.
Yeah.
And it's so funny. Let's take another break.
One of the things we talk about on here and remind you guys of is that we have a network, Blaze Media, which has Blaze TVs under that. And they're the reason why we're able to have this podcast, Unashamed. And also, they're the reason that we have In the Woods with Phil. And so we let you know whenever they give like a discount, and they've got a really good one up until the election. They're trying to get more folks over to check out Blaze Media and Blaze TV. Basically, you get $30 off your annual subscription, which is a huge savings. That's $5.75 a month, which how much is a can of snuff these days, Jay?
$4 or $5.
There you go. Yeah. So it's about the price of a can of snuff for you dippers out there. It's inexpensive. It's a great network. Not only do you get Dad's Show, all episodes, however many there is, 600 episodes plus. Plus you get Marco Venn, you get Glenn Beck, everybody that's on the network. So we wanted to get you guys to go check those guys out, BlazeTV.com, and check that out. Also have UnashamedMerch.com if you're looking for hats or shirts or things that have Unashamed on there as well. So check them out.
So they'll even take good fruit, Al, and turn it into bad fruit.
Well, and you're right. And I've heard this argument before about that, about the ma'am and that sort of thing. And like, I guess it's maybe.
You know, Trey Gowdy, South Carolina, Southern boy, you know, he says, yes, ma'am. I heard him say that.
Yeah, he does all the time. And that, but people from up north tell me that, yeah, who are believers, but they tell me that, like, it's a sign of disrespect, which I can't. I can't.
Well, they say because it makes them old.
Is that what it is?
That's what I heard.
Oh, I don't
know. Because I'm, not, I'm quite, not an authority on
I'm sure somebody.
No, it doesn't change their years on the earth.
Well, typically.
Phil, I'm just telling you what I heard. I don't agree. I think it's the dumbest
I'm
thing
just,
ever.
I'm just saying.
You do typically do it to older people. People are older than you. That is true. I wouldn't say that necessarily to a 20-year-old girl.
I honestly don't know what the problem is.
I don't either. Somebody in the audience will let me know, I'm sure, but because I can't figure it out. I don't see how it is disrespectful.
Well,
I know one thing. In our culture here in the South, it is very much meant as a respect.
They call it, what are they calling it now? Mansplaining?
Mansplaining. Yeah.
Mansplaining.
That's the latest.
Well, the opening the door is,
But I've I would open the door. Like if I'm about to walk in a convenience store, somebody's walking up, male or female.
Agreed.
I hold the door open for them.
Open the door.
I mean, so this has nothing to do with gender. It's not just, I just do it for the ladies. I would do it for anybody walking up.
But a guy in New York told me one time, he's like, it's just because you're taking the time. We don't like that. We want to be walking apart from each other with our head down, and we don't want anybody. Kind of what you were reading about, don't be dependent on anyone. They don't want you opening the door. They took that verse, theoretically.
The thought of it, yeah.
And went crazy with it. They're like, we don't want you opening
that is
the
true.
Door for us.
That is true, Jase, that people in huge cities, from my observation, I've never lived in one, are the least community people you've ever seen in your life.
So you walk through a door, you walk through a door, and you look around, and there's a woman coming with a bag of groceries or a kid, and you hold the door open. Or they're saying, no, you don't do that. So you just walk through it. And who cares who's behind you? A lot of doors slam rather heartily. So a door slams in the face, and you're going to try to make the argument to me that there's something wrong with you standing there instead of the door slamming in their face. You let them walk by, and then you release the door going about your business. And you're trying to tell me there's something wrong. It's the age-old thing about when they start calling right wrong and call what's wrong right.
Yeah,
that's pretty well sums
but
it up.
But you nailed it, because it really is about kindness. I love somebody's doing ads. Y'all have seen them before. They're like PSAs where the big old huge burly guy's on a bus, and there's a little old lady, there's people standing on the bus, and he sits there, it's like, acts of kindness or whatever, and then he says, man, would you like my seat? And she sits down in his seat, and he grabs the thing, and that's it. That was just the commercial. But it was like, I love that.
So if kindness
that has nothing to do with gender. That's just something.
I think it's a cultural thing.
If kindness is, in fact, fruit of the spirit, what they're backing and what they're pushing forward, what's the fruit? The fruit of what?
Rudeness.
Huh?
But they like it. That's what I'm saying. Yeah.
But when you flip kindness on its head, or you say ma'am, or you open the door for somebody, and they're finding fault with that, fault finders, when you see that, you're like, where are they getting their ideas from? Not the Bible.
But Missy and I argued every time we went to New York, because I'd go into a coffee shop, why start talking to people? Because I like people. I like talk. We're waiting in the line.
Well,
but they're not talking to me. And she'll whisper and say, please quit talking to these people. And I'm like, I'm trying to make conversation. What's up with you? Are you in a bad mood? And she's like, this is New York. They don't want you to talk. They're scared of the way you look anyway, overall. And they just don't really care for your Southern conversation. Because people say, well, you have an accent. I was like, well, I was going to say the same thing with you.
I'm going back to John the Baptist and Jesus. Bear good. It's how people recognize who you are. Yeah. So if the worst claim you ever have when you get to heaven, and you say, well, I notice you were really, you opened the door for women, older people, you respected all men. That's kind of what I think the goal is.
I think some of it, though, Phil, is just personality. It's like some of my wife's family, you know, they're kind of syrupy, a little too syrupy for me. You know, it's like, I feel like if a guy comes up, even though we're family, and is like, you know, telling me they love me in a nice way and just kind of rubbing my shoulder, I'm like, you know, this is too much.
What I'm saying is,
because we're the least touchy feeling people on the planet, but the three of us sitting at
this argument table. Came up. Well, he has a good heart. He's trying to do how he feels is showing the fruit of the spirit, but I'm like, back off a little bit. So then Missy she made this point to me. She's like, well, that's the way people feel in New York when you're just saying, hey, how y'all doing? Well, maybe you have a, so I'm, it may not be so much a heart.
If you have a stem winder of a hairdo and you're female.
A stem winder.
Never heard that word in my life.
Well, let me give you a little insight of what it looks like.
Is that a word?
I'm looking at the hairdo, and first of all, it's either bright orange and or whatever, purple, and it's cut on both sides. There's locks going here and there. I usually say, now, honey, that is a hairdo right there. How long did it take you to do that? And they'll laugh, and they'll say, hour and a half. I said, so it took you an hour and a half to get that looking like that. I said, that is quite the hairdo. I'm bragging on the woman.
I got this spelled wrong. It says stem winder, an entertaining and rousing speech.
That's what it literally means. But
a watch wound by turning a knob,
which is saying, wow, what a hairdo. That's a stem winder.
Right. It's the actual meaning is about a speech, but it could apply to that. But what's funny is that, so you're thinking the same thing I think. I do the same thing. That if you did that, that you want people to notice.
I think so.
I mean, you wouldn't do the stem winder with the pink and the purple and all that. So I always comment on it because I'm thinking, you know what? I guess they want us to say something because most people don't have pink hair.
These days in America, when it comes to hairdos, I'm afraid we're the best in the world at top this.
Well,
and I'm wanting to know how they did it.
To be honest, actually, Dad, it started in Europe. We picked it up from the you already see them over in Europe, and they were doing it a long time ago.
What was this?
No, the crazy hairdos, the spiked hairdos. Remember, I mean, that goes back 20, 30 years.
I usually say something. I'm like, wow. That's, I mean, I like what that's crazy, but and there again, he's like, why do you have to say it? Everybody sees it. Why do you have to say
that?
She spent a lot of time
right. I
doing
think she
it,
wants you
and
to
I'm
say
like,
something.
You that definitely stands out. If that's what you were going for,
so let's take another.
And
break.
You did it. Whoa.
So back to what we were talking about a minute ago, Dad. So I had a next door neighbor years ago, and they moved down here from Illinois. And they were, you know, and yeah, somebody moves in, I instantly go over, and they were not nice initially, just kind of standoffish, and, you know, say, hey, anything we can do to help you? You know, we probably took them something, you know, it's just kind of neighborly, you know, what we do here. And so we kind of started getting to know him through the son, who later we led to Christ, who's a member here at WFR. He married a girl from here. But it was really interesting. Once we got to know them better, she explained to me where they were from in Illinois. You just didn't, just what Jason said, you didn't talk to people, you didn't ask them questions. Because when she got here, she hated it when she first went to work. Because she said, they just come in and start grilling me with questions. And I was like, like what? And they were like, how are you doing? And you know, what? I mean, she goes through this.
How is your day?
Yeah, exactly. Just like typical remarks you would talk to somebody at
work. So if I said to somebody, they walk by, hey, how's it going? And they're like, and they're mad.
She hated it, like at first. And it was funny because through the
year. How's it going means.
Yeah. That's, you know, like, hey.
That's what I'm not saying. Is it. There's a difference between a heart issue.
She took that as an interrogation because people were just being friendly talking to her.
Is it a heart issue or is it a culture issue? Where, I mean, well, I think what you're saying, in light of the towel washing that he was saying, it, you see very few people who humble themselves are doing something that is requires what? I mean, a lot of humility and... I mean, it's dirty, and I mean, I'd feel uncomfortable about washing somebody's feet.
Well,
especially y'all's.
Yeah, you don't want to wash mine. Well, and back and to wrap her up. So, what was interesting is I lived next door to him for a couple of years, and then we built another house and moved away. But her son was led to Christ, and still is a great, solid guy here. And then eventually, she returned to her faith through the years of being here, and she was softened with that person that first got here. But to your point, it really was as much about not having the Holy Spirit and not being able to bear that fruit as much as it was a cultural thing.
That's the reason.
And then I spoke at her funeral. I did her funeral.
Right. I mean, it's like criticism. Nobody likes criticism. I mean, you can imagine from as many people who listen to what we talk about, and we get stuff wrong, and people, you know, they'll send us emails or whatever. We've all seen them. And to me, it's like, well, a lot of times the argument, if it's just an argument, I'm like, yeah, you're right. We had that, me and Zach, you know, got into it about football. I got to thinking about it. He's probably right.
Right.
But I'm so frustrated because I just like the game that it frustrates me that people are using that.
Right.
So,
but if y'all remember.
But Phil, let me finish my point. But if somebody sends me an attack deal, if they immediately get personal, if they're like, I don't agree with you, well, that's fine. Because I just said, that's probably wrong on that one. But when you get personal then and say, but you're a self-righteous, no good first seat, well, whatever you're going to say, I'm out. Because the fruit of this confrontation is all bad. Yep. There, it crossed a line, which is my point. You can see this in every situation in life, not just bad, but in conflict.
Right.
And, I mean, you know how that is. Yep. So that's all I wanted to say, Phil.
Well, I would just say, you know, the Apostle Paul to Timothy, what did he say? Pursue righteousness. Don't have anything to do with foolish and stupid arguments because you know they produce quarrels.
You just summed up my whole life, Phil.
Well,
I appreciate it.
But that's a far cry from now. I remember when y'all were boys, young boys, one of the things I told y'all in lieu of, you know, obey your teachers, I said you'll have some great teachers, you'll have some teachers that are pretty good, and you'll have some poor ones. I said, obey them all. I said, you're there, they're there, they may not be the greatest teacher in the world. I said, show a respect. And I also told y'all, respect older people.
Yep.
I said, as a rule, just respect them. Mm-hmm. Now, they can say what they want to, but when I see younger, you know, junior high kids, yes, sir, Ms. Robertson, yes, sir, and they're saying sir to me, I take that as that boy's got, he's got a good heart. Yeah. I mean, that tells you a lot about a young buck that's in the eighth grade, but he's very respectful toward the people around him. Now, they can say what they want to about bearing fruit, but that's good fruit. I don't care what they say.
Well, Phil,
it's good fruit.
I think it comes down to, you got John 15, but you just think about what we just had. In John 13, Jesus basically said we need a world full of feet washers. And in John 8, he said we got too many rock throwers. And when you think about what the problem is in our culture, in our in America, we got way too many rock throwers and not enough feet washers.
Yeah.
And that's across the board. That's
But the issue we were speaking of is the produced fruit in keeping with repentance. You're like, So I'm just saying, take all the school children, the young ones in the grade school, the junior high and the high school, and don't forget the college crowd. If you looked at it, just step back and looked at it on what they're not teaching. Guys, they're not teaching respect for older people, being kind to your neighbor, yes, ma'am, no, ma'am, holding the door open, keeping your mouth shut and not. I mean, if you just look at it, I wonder if it would help if we had some type, used to, the code was there without anybody saying it.
Right.
When we were younger, all we respected teachers and older people and law enforcement and anybody else was old and new. We respected them. We were taught that.
Well, we were. Let's take a look, another break.
But we've lost that.
Well, you remember we talked about it with Lieutenant Colonel West up in the previous podcast, and he outlined it perfectly. As we've moved away from the biblical roots and traditional families, and all that was so tied into our culture, there was a time where you would have expected that at any classroom or whatever. But now we're moving away generationally where you got more and more people that don't know the root. Remember, it's all about the vine in John 15.
Yeah.
And so if you don't even know about the vine, how could you ever produce good fruit? I mean, that's what you're seeing. So,
there's my point.
But you had to plug people back into
it. You made my point. It took you and old Jase, especially. It took y'all about 20 minutes to get it, but I think you got it.
I got it right out the bat.
Instantaneously. I was just offering some thoughts.
We were giving some underpinnings.
I was trying to make the whole book of John, I mean, look at it from an overview. Okay, yeah, we're to the bearing fruit, but I mean, what about these other things?
But it struck me, why would John the Baptist, without any explanation, just say, you bunch of brood of vipers, you know, produce fruit in keeping with repentance.
Yeah.
I mean, and they were people who were anti-Jesus. And yeah. I mean, look.
They were perceived, to Jason's point earlier, they were perceived as being the most religious people.
Yeah.
But Phil, in our offendable world, I see why it happened. Look, the last time I spoke, I can't keep up with how long. It wasn't very long ago. Well, I had a guy there. After it was over on my way out, he's like, now, y'all know what I got one speech, and it's 99% about Jesus.
Would you call it a stem winder?
Oh, by the way, let me read this. Look, let me read this, because I had it pulled up. When I read this a while ago, look, a stem winder, it says, when you're listening to one, a stem winder, it feels like time has stopped. And you may check to see if your watch needs resetting. But used correctly, the word describes a rousing speech. So you're so caught up in the speech that you literally think that time
stands still.
Well, I thought about Jesus when he said he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. That's why everything he said literally was a stem winder.
Oh, that's right.
You're like, he's eternal, and he's giving you some inside secrets to life.
That's right.
But look, I speak, so this guy hollers at me. He's like, I don't think, you know, next time lay off the drinking. And I thought, that's weird. So I stopped when I heard that. I mean, I'm literally walking through the kitchen to the car, because when I'm over, and I was like, do what now? And he's like, well, you may offend somebody. It'll help you. Just thought I'd let you know that. So I was like, what did I say about drinking? But I tell, you know, in my speech, I tell your story about, you know, here's a man pre-Jesus. He was drinking way too much, you know, and I go through all that. So then I share about the transformation. I spend 99% of it on why the transformation occurred, which is Jesus. I go through the Bible. What's the point? Jesus, he's coming. He's here. He's coming again. Well, when I get to the end, I talk about when Jesus is real. things change. To get to your point about John the Baptist, produce fruit in keeping with repentance. Repentance is a decision to change. So now if you believe Jesus is real, he is the Son of God, he's all-knowing, all-powerful, you're introduced by it. Well, things should change. Well, I use that as an example. Now, granted, where I spoke last time, it was not a church event. I would say a few of the people had drank too much. Right. Well, I made a comment about speaking at that fundraiser for the Trumps that I did. Yeah. Now, there, most people had way too much drink. So I made a little funny joke that was like they had too much to drink and too few of clothes. And I was talking to the women. I was like, they needed more. I think that's what I said, more clothes and less drink. Because I wasn't even sure they would understand what I was saying.
Right.
But then I quoted the passage in Ephesians. So I'm high on Jesus. About the Spirit. Don't get drunk. Yeah. So that was my deal. But I got to thinking, now he heard that whole lesson and he concluded, that's too much on drinking. And I thought, he's not, he missed something. I don't even think it's wrong to drink, you know. But I was looking at a few of the people, and by their fruit, I realized there were some people in that audience that had way too much to drink. If you get up and take two steps and fall over and everybody laughs, you've had too much.
And the reason you're saying that is that by their fruit, you can recognize them.
That's right.
When you get a bunch of
people. That was my point.
And they get drunked up. When I used to get drunked up, the last thing you're ever going to see is any kind of love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control.
I think
coming out of that.
Yeah, I think the guy said it, because when I picked up the Bible, because I did the duck call. I told y'all about that in the previous podcast. But when I picked the Bible, there was three or four people who got up and left. Didn't want to hear it. And so he was probably thinking, if you hadn't have been offensive on the drinking, they might not have left. But I didn't. All I did was say basically your story. But I should have just said, hey, I ain't got a problem with drinking. Just when you drink too much, your fruit is not helping you. That's a dead end. You're going to wind up dead in prison in a 12-step rehab program.
Well, it was like you described with Dad. I mean, just from our own experiences, you know, he had to leave a lifestyle to get to Jesus to then be changed to be different. I mean,
right.
You know, so because if you hadn't have stepped away from that lifestyle of the people and the fruit that you were bearing, you would have never been able to be introduced to Christ.
But the reason was Jesus. That's my point. So as you said, took you 20 minutes, took y'all about a year and a half to get my point. It doesn't matter what behavior you insert in there. I could have inserted anything. You could list a fruit a mile long. We've talked about all kinds, good or bad. If you don't have Jesus and he's not real to you, the fruit that's going to come out is not going to be real anyway.
People forget that I didn't forget my past. And the last thing you'd have seen me do is hold the door open for somebody, but all right, every man for himself, every woman for himself. I wouldn't have held the door open, and I wouldn't have called you sir or ma'am. Right. No, there was none of that with me, none.
Right.
So I just remember the fruit that I bore that leads to death. I remember that fruit, and when I repented, I just started, in keeping with repentance, I started bearing good fruit.
Right.
I mean, to me, it's common sense.
And you're right. And for those that we didn't give you the exact passage, but those of you that want to look into that, I encourage you this week to read Galatians 5:16-26.
Yeah, look up fruit in your concordance.
Yeah, or do a fruit study. That's
look,
right.
Look up
James
fruit.
3 has another one.
When you get done, get back with me on whether we should be nice to women and open the door for people.
There's a lot of
be kind to old men and women. Right. Right.
There's a lot of paragraphs in the Bible that has, here's what you were, here's what you are.
Right.
There's tons of them. So, I mean, the list. So you need to, nothing wrong with lists. But my point is that we're not policemen. We don't go around and try to sanction every behavioral issue, because in the end, we're all flawed and we're all going to mess up. But there is fruit, good and bad. I mean, not doing the bad and doing the good is what I mean. That
and what
comes
the, what,
out
what
of
the
a
guy,
spirit.
What the guy missed with you is you never claimed to be the judge. You just work for the judge.
Well, right.
I mean, the judge of people's hearts is not us. Mm-hmm. Like, even if we see fruit and we think, boy, that old gal there or that old boy there. But even then, I'm not condemning. I'm just an observer.
It was a strange confrontation. Look, you know what my assistant, she said? She said, you must have hit a nerve with him. I thought,
well, that's what I thought too.
Here it speaks of the fruit of the righteous, that we may offer the fruit of our lips, reap the fruit of unfailing love, showed me a book at a basket of ripe fruit, producing fruit in keeping with repentance. And what Jesus said, by their fruit you will recognize them, in Matthew 7. Good fruit, a bad tree bears bad. And you just start down the list. It's mentioned in Romans, Galatians, Philippians, Colossians, Hebrews, James, Jude, and Revelation, producing fruit. So I'm just saying, my overall view of fruit is people need to bear a certain kind of fruit, and the fruit had better be good fruit, not 40, bad.
48 minutes later, we got the point, which is awesome because we're out of time.
Thanks for listening to the Unashamed Podcast. Help us out by rating us on iTunes. And don't miss an episode by subscribing on YouTube, and be sure to click that little bell to get notified about new episodes. And for even more content that you won't get anywhere else, subscribe to Blaze TV at blazetv.com/unashamed.